Welcome to The Hair Loss Show, where Dr. Russell Knudsen and Dr. Vikram Jayaprakash discuss issues relating to hair loss and the medical and surgical treatment of hair loss in both men and women.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Hair Loss Show. I'm Dr. Russell Knudsen.
And I'm Dr. Vikram Jayaprakash.
So welcome back. And thank you very much for everybody that is subscribing. And if you haven't subscribed yet, please do. It helps the ranking, and that helps get the message out to more people about the information we're trying to get here. So thank you if you have subscribed, and we would encourage you to subscribe if you haven't yet done so. Today, we are going to kind of revisit the topic just in one aspect, which is about the dosing of finasteride. Because for those of you who have seen some of our other videos about finasteride, you know that Vikram and I believe in customized dosing and microdosing rather than one size fits all approach with finasteride. So we get asked this question about, you know, how much can you use, and you know, if this much is good, is more better. So we see this a bit in patients, and there's a temptation for some of our patients to self-medicate.
Yes, absolutely.
Because they think that more is better. Mm-hmm. So I think we just need to run through a couple of basic facts again, so people understand the strategy behind what we're talking about. If we look at what's called a dose response curve, which means the dose versus what you get, it keeps going up in a pretty, you know, sort of standard fashion to about 0.5 of a milligram. And then when you get to 0.8 of a milligram, it starts to, this is 0.8 milligrams here, you're at this leveling off period where anything above that doesn't really increase the amount of finasteride that's in your system. Mm-hmm. So the dose that was chosen as the standard dose is a milligram, because it more or less is at that level, and that's easy, I suppose, to do it at a 1 milligram level. But if you're down here at 0.5 of a milligram, you're still getting, you know, significant amount of enzyme blockade, with, in our experience, a reduction in the possibility of side effects.
Yes.
So the other thing that factors in, not just the dose, but the interval, right? So so often we will do 0.5, for example, if you average it out, or you can do a milligram every second day, for example, the same sort of thing. But the other thing to remember about it is how long it lasts in the body. So if you look at it, how long it lasts in the blood, not so long, it's a matter of 6 or 8 hours. But if you look at how long it lasts in the skin at a significant level, it's 30 days, which is a month, all right? So this is another reason why we're happy with this lower dose schedule, because it builds up. And we see this in some of our patients. Mm-hmm. You know, it's uncommon in our practices to get side effects, but there are two distinct patterns. There are the people that react in the first week or two, you stop the medication, they recover in a week or two, and maybe you come back in at a lower dose and see if they'll tolerate a lower dose. Because our philosophy is, something's better than nothing, right? Because you're going to get some kind of effect that helps them. Then there's the second category of patients where they get it after 6, 8, 10, 12 months, or even up to 18 months. And I think that's just this fact here, that they've just loaded up this system, loaded up this system, loaded up this system using the standard dose. Mm-hmm. And eventually it overwhelms the system and they get the side effect. And when you do that, it doesn't recover in a couple of weeks. It takes months to recover. And this, I think, it feeds into this idea of the post-finasteride syndrome. I think this is a function of the long half-life of the medication, where it takes a long while to work its way out of the system. So basically, I don't believe people taking more than 7 milligrams a week makes sense, which is a milligram a day. Some people, because of cost, will take a 5 milligram tablet and cut it into quarters and take that every day because they think that's better and it's cheaper. Well, that's nearly 9 milligrams. Right, so again, it's wasteful in the sense that we don't believe that past about 5 milligrams a week, that's going to make any difference whatsoever, because the dose response curve flattens off at 0.8. So I would encourage people to think along those lines and not think that more is better, and that if they're not responding at the level that they are, at the milligram level, that going to 1.25 milligrams or 1.5 milligrams is going to make any sense, because it really isn't going to help the issue.
So I think that's a really valid point. And I think it's really important to, from our perspective, we understand that there are people that sort of, you know, everyone works in the middle, but there's also those extremes. There's the people that really want to go on, not necessarily feel that they need to be on a higher dose. and want to push the envelope. And there's people at the other end of the spectrum who we would, for example, recommend, oh yeah, let's take a milligram, essentially half a milligram a day or a milligram three times a week. Let's just say Monday, Wednesday, Friday for ease of reference. And then let me go, well, actually, how about if that's too much? Why don't I start at a lower dose, right? How about I just take half of that on Monday, on Wednesday and Friday? What's your thoughts on that?
I think that's a sensible approach because a number of patients come to us fearful. They've read about the side effects profiles and they really are convinced that that a large number of people get it. So I'll often start nice and low just to prove to the patient
that it's safe, it's okay.
And that they're not going to get the side effect. And then we just dial it up according to the response. And I think the other thing we need to, remember is two other factors. Number one is, three factors. Stability is success. Mm-hmm. So people coming back to us and saying it's no better, it's no worse. So that's, it's not doing anything. If it's no worse, it's doing something because generally this is going to progress.
Yeah.
And so, but if you're going to see any improvement, it's at least 6 months away. So it's like anything we try for hair loss, because of the nature of the cycle, if you're not doing it, prepared to do it for 6 or 12 months, you're never giving it a chance to really see what it's going to do. So that's the second factor. You need to do it for long enough. And the third factor is you need to differentiate between shedding and hair loss. Mm. So when we look at the studies on finasteride, and this was done in young men between the ages of 18 and 49, at 1 year, 86%, photographically were no worse, 83% were no worse at 2 years, and at 5 years, 64% were no worse. So that's a pretty good hit rate. But I'm going to tell you that in my practice, week in, week out, the number of my patients that come in on finasteride that tell me that they're not stable at 6 or 12 months, is probably 80% of them.
Right.
None of them believe that they're stable because, this hairline's moved back a little bit. I didn't used to be able to see that freckle before. And so what's happening in our practices doesn't reflect what the research shows. And it's because I think a lot of our patients are misunderstanding with shedding and thinking that means that they're having continued hair loss. So I photograph them, I measure the height of the hairline from the eyebrow to reassure them and show them on the video microscope what the hairs look like, the hair shafts.
Yes.
And I also ask them about their shedding. Are they, long, dark hairs or are they short, wispy hairs? And I say, oh, no, they're normal length hairs. Well, they're just healthy hairs.
Yeah.
And so I think we need to address those misunderstandings. This is a very successful medicine. It's the most important medicine in the 40 years I've been treating people. But if people are not stable on the dosing of finasteride that we give, and let's just say we get to 7 milligrams, just as an argument's sake, which is a milligram a day. If they really aren't stable on that, then increasing the finasteride dose has no impact whatsoever. Mm-hmm. That's when we bring other measures into play. And for example, it may be dutasteride, right, which isn't an approved use for hair loss, but we know that it is actually about 50% stronger than finasteride. So I might swap out some finasteride and put a bit of dutasteride in just to up the ante a little bit. So just to be reassuring to you, just upping the dose of finasteride isn't going to help you once you get past 5 or 7 milligrams a week.
I think it's important to outline, we talk about customized dosing. It's also a customized treatment plan because it's not a one size fits all for everyone. Some people do need a little bit of a second agent into the mix. Some people are perfectly stable on singular therapy.
Yes.
I think you and I are very similar in the sense that the ultimate goal is for this patient to be stable and to be on the lowest dose of the least number of medications.
Yeah.
That will provide that outcome.
Yeah, so normally I do like to combine an enzyme blocking agent with a stimulant.
Mm-hmm.
And most of my patients will begin on finasteride and minoxidil as a mix and try and keep it to those two so that we can assess it properly. And, because patients then say, oh, yes, but what about, I want to use dermarolling oil and I want to use PRP and I want to use any other of the agents around. I'm going, well, you can do all of that, and that's fine, and they may be useful, but it's going to be very hard for us to logically assess for you what's working and what isn't. So I like you, this incremental approach where we start with a blocker, usually with a stimulator, unless it's someone that's got minor hair loss. If I have a 50-year-old man in front of me with a just a little bit of hair loss at the hairline or a tiny bit of thinning, and he's going, you know, I just want to hang on to this. I'm not going to go gangbusters and over-treat that. I'm going to start with a very low dose of finasteride and see if it works.
Yeah.
And do monotherapy.
Yeah.
But anybody under the age of 35, I'm probably going to offer stimulation to you because they've got a long time in front of them to lose hair. And yeah, the take-home message is we're better at preventing hair loss
than
we are at regrowing it.
Yeah. So, I mean, coming back, just to finish up, we've got the dose on the higher end of the scale. Yes, you can trial a lower dose, but with the understanding that we need to titrate it to the outcome. Yes. And the outcome being stability. So yes, there are some people that can absolutely take a half a milligram three times a week and be stable, but more than likely for most people, you're going to need to push up the dose.
I think that the sweet spot for me is 3 to 5 milligrams a week of finasteride, plus or minus dutasteride if we're still a little bit concerned about it at the end. And you know, this comes back to what we've talked about in other videos about the aggressiveness of the balding. It's, you know, you've got a young man with a lot of hair loss, you have to go harder.
Yes.
All right. You've got an older man with a very small amount of hair loss, you don't have to go hard at all. So this is the customization. It's the degree of balding and the age of the patient that influences our choices in these matters.
Perfect. All right. So that's another sort of recap on dosing of finasteride. You know, we talk a lot, like Russell was saying, we talk a lot about this because I think it's important, and also the feedback that we're getting from people. They want to understand what the dosing is for them and what is optimized. So I think that's a worthwhile discussion to have. So again, thanks again for watching. Hope you found that useful, and we'll see you again on the next episode.
Thank you.